Well, welcome everyone. Hello and good morning. I'm Stephanie with the Scientist in Every Florida School program. Here with us today, we are going to be stepping into the garden, a virtual field trip series presented by Mounts Botanical Garden and Scientist in Every Florida School. Today's event will take a look at bats and the different niches that they fill within ecosystems, some of which are plant pollinators, much like bees are. Scientist in Every Florida School is a free program that's based at the Thompson Earth Systems Institute within the University of Florida, and we have a mission to engage Florida K-12 students and teachers in cutting-edge research by providing science role models like today, experiences like today, that hopefully inspire future stewards of our planet. Mounts Botanical Garden, our partner, is a nationally acclaimed attraction for Florida residents and visitors alike, with a mission that is to inspire and educate through nature. So I'm going to pass things over to April from Mounts at this point in time to tell us just a little bit about their space before we get started. April?
Thank you, Stephanie. Hi, everyone. My name is April. I work here at Mounts Botanical Garden, and we are a 16-acre tropical oasis right here in Palm Beach County. We're the oldest garden here in the Palm Beaches. We have 25 different gardens with 5,000 different species of tropical and subtropical plants. The screen you're looking at right now on your left, that is one of our gardens. It's a wetland garden. It's called Windows on the Floating World. And as you can see, it looks like people are walking right across the water. So if you were to come visit, you could come visit this garden and see. On the other side on the right, we have a little duckweed down here, and at the top we have a water lily. So we have all different kinds of plants. They all require pollinators. We have butterflies, bees, birds. At nighttime we have moths, and we also have bats. That's what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Verity Mathis. She's our expert today, and she's going to tell us about bat pollination. We're very excited. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Let me just share my screen here. Okay. So everybody can see that correctly, I hope. And all right, so thank you so much. My name is Verity Mathis, and I am the Mammal Collections Manager at the Florida Museum of Natural History here in Gainesville, Florida. And just to really kind of quickly talk a little bit about the collections and where I work, just so you have an idea. So the Florida Museum of Natural History is home to millions and millions of objects from all around the world. And those include specimens like mammals, birds, fishes, herps, fossils, vertebrate paleontology fossils, invertebrate fossils, as well as cultural objects from like anthropology and archaeology. So I work in the mammal collection. I take care of all of our mammal specimens. And our specimens, we kind of like look at our museum as like a library of life where researchers from all around the world can access our specimens. We lend them to them, they come visit us, and these specimens are used for research and education and outreach. And all these specimens, we have data associated with them, so we know where they were collected over space and time, and they can really help inform over a wide range of research topics. So we have these cabinets. I'm sitting currently right now in the very back where the shelves in that cabinet in the very back there are. That's where I am at this moment. We have open shelving with our larger specimens. Like you can see some of our whales here, some of our hooved mammals in the bottom there. And all these cabinets contain a variety of skeletal material as well as study skins, like some of these bats, like what we'll be talking about today. And these bats are preserved. They're just stuffed with cotton wire. And they are the bats in this particular picture. I don't know if you can read the tags, but these guys were collected in the early 1930s, and they look just as good today as they did when they were first preserved over 90 years ago. And so my job is to make sure that they are continue to be preserved for the next 90 years, if not longer. And so with the data, we can do genetic research, morphology research, ecological research, you name it. Somebody has probably used the museum specimen to help inform our better understanding of biodiversity. And so I also get to the opportunities to do field work. So some of these pictures are from when we were in the Bahamas, where we were netting bats in caves there and collecting tissue samples from those bats. And I also get to do outreach and education, like talking to y'all today, and preparing specimens, doing identifications, a little bit of everything. So now that you kind of have an idea of what I do for my job, let's talk about bats. So bats let's just face it, they're amazing, right? So there are over 1,400 species of bats in the world today. And new bat species are literally being discovered almost every day, either from people going to new remote areas where they've never been seen before and describing new species, or using genetics and morphology from museum specimens to help us better understand those cryptic diversity. And to put it a little into context, there are over 5,000 species of mammals in the world. So bats make up about a quarter of all mammalian diversity, which is a really huge chunk. And they come in a variety of shapes and sizes. So just some really quick facts. I could spend so much time just talking about bats themselves, but we don't have a ton of time today. So bats come in a variety of shapes and sizes, like I said. There's huge flying foxes, like this giant flying fox in the Philippines that can have 6-foot wingspans, all the way down to some of the tiniest mammals in the world, like this bumblebee bat, which weighs only about a couple of grams. Bats are the only mammals that are capable of powered flight, as you probably know, and they can fly some amazing heights and distances. So bats can fly 60 miles per hour or more in a night while they're out foraging or if they're migrating. And some species are also capable of very high altitude flight. And when they're migrating in huge numbers, they can actually be picked up on a radar, like the Doppler radar, where you see like the storms coming through that looks like a cloud of bats actually coming through. Bats are actually very long lived for their size. So the oldest known bat is a species that's shown in this picture here called Brandt's myotis. And this bat was recorded to living 41 years in the wild, which is really amazing for a small mammal of their size. And on average, they can live about 30 years in the wild. And you compare that to the fact that they don't really have a lot of babies in a year. So most bats only have about one pup per year. Sometimes they might have two, but generally it's a very low reproductive output for such a small mammal. So bats, if you name it, a bat is probably capable of eating it. They have a wide variety of diets. So not only are there pollinator bats, like we're going to talk a little bit about today, which feed on nectar. Bats are insectivorous, like the bats we have here in Florida. We'll talk a little bit about that as well. There are bats that eat fruit, like that bat in the center there. They eat fruit and disperse the seeds. And there's bats that are carnivorous that actually can eat frogs and fish and even small rodents sometimes. And of course, there is blood-sucking bats. But I always want to emphasize that there are, out of the 1,400 plus species of bats, only 3 are actual blood drinkers. And those are only found in Central or South America and South America. So they're not here in North America at all. And they tend to drink off, not on humans, but other like cattle and domestic animals like that, livestock. Bats are found in a variety of structures, no matter where they are found. So they like to be in places where they can feel kind of safe and secure because they are pretty defenseless, right? They're small mammals. So they can be found in trees and cavities in trees and under the bark of trees, like in that center picture there. They can make tents out of palms and leaves in the tropics. The bigger bats sometimes just do roost in trees like we see in the bottom here. They are, of course, found in caves. And they're also found in human structures like attics and barns and bridges like the famous Congress Street Bridge on the corner there, which is found in Austin, Texas, and has thousands upon thousands upon thousands of Mexican free-tailed bats. So bats can provide some amazing ecosystem services that almost no other mammal can provide. So the insectivorous bats can eat millions and millions of agricultural and garden pests, including mosquitoes. Pollinator bats can pollinate over 300 species of plants, including many of the fruits that we enjoy, like bananas and mango. The fruit-eating bats, which are frugivorous, disperse seeds through their guano, which is, you know, a fancy way of saying bat poop. So that poop itself is an important fertilizer that is used in many, many gardens. And you can frequently buy it in the store because it's such a good common fertilizer. And so bats, of course, echolocate, which many people know about. Bats and cetaceans like whales and dolphins are the two groups of mammals that are capable of echolocation. So basically bats, they make this noise through, most of them make it through their mouths. Some species do echolocate through their noses, but they basically, they're flying around at night, it's dark. They are trying to avoid running into things because even though they can see, it's still dark in the woods, and it's trying to avoid branches and trees when you're flying around looking for your insects. So they echolocate and they send the sonar signals through their mouths, and that signal bounces off the objects that they want to avoid. And then they can also detect the insects that they're trying to find based on the sonar that bounces back to them. And so I'm gonna play really quickly, just a little clip of a silver-haired bat echolocating. You can hear those clicks. Hopefully that's coming through. Awesome. So a lot of bats echolocate at an audible frequency that we can hear, and some don't. And so when people are looking to survey bats in the, you know, we're doing bat surveys driving around, we have these bat monitors that pick up this echolocation. And based on the frequency of the bat, we can frequently tell what species is in that area because they have very unique frequencies. So let's talk a little bit about Florida bats. Florida, there are 13 species of bats that are found here. There are two families of bats. So bats are grouped into various families based on their genetics, based on their morphology and location. So we have two families. The biggest family of bats we have here in Florida is called the family Vespertilionidae. And this includes what we call the tree bats, which are the bats at the very top of the screen there, the seminal bat, the yellow bat, and the eastern bat, as well as the hoary bat there in the corner. And they're called tree bats because they like to roost in trees. These bats like to be like under the bark of trees and in cavities. You generally won't find them in any human-made structures. And they're very beautiful bats. They have these bright, you know, yellow, orange, reddish, mahogany coats. The hoary bat has a silver tip coat. And so they're very just charismatic and very cute, in my opinion. And we also have the big brown bat and the southeastern myotis bat, which are found here. Those can be found in a variety of structures, including caves and cavities of trees. And then we have the tricolored bat, which is often found in caves here in Florida, and the evening bat, which can be found in a variety of habitats and areas. We have the gray bat, which is a federally endangered bat species, which is only known from, I think, maybe one cave up in northern panhandle area of Florida. And then we have my personal favorite, which is the Raffinesky's bigger bat, which just has these amazingly huge ears. And so how can you not love a bat like that? And then the other family of bats we have here in Florida include the family Molossidae. And so that includes the Brazilian free-tailed bat in the top right there. And 9 times out of 10, if you're seeing a bat flying around in the evening time or coming out of a bat house, that's the bat species that you're probably seeing. This species is extremely common throughout all of Florida. It's actually extremely widespread. It's found all the way from Canada down through South America and then throughout the Caribbean. And this is the bat that is capable, this is one of the bat species that is capable of high altitude flight and very long distance flight. So they can fly, you know, over 60 miles an hour. They've actually been clocked up at 100 miles per hour on some occasions. And they, some of the species do migrate. The ones we have in Florida are here year round. They're resident bats. But the same species of Brazilian free-tailed bat that's found out west does migrate down to Mexico during the wintertime. And then we also have the Florida bonneted bat, which is another federally endangered bat species here in the state. And this is our only endemic species. So that means the Florida bat is found only in Florida and is found nowhere else in the world. It's primarily known from South Florida, that they have discovered some new populations a little bit more north central. So it's expanding. They have found it outside of this just the South Florida region now. It's also our biggest bat, so it's a really good size bat. It's very charismatic as well, and there are a lot of studies going on to try to better understand its needs and its habits to better know how to manage it. And then we also have the velvety free-tailed bat, which is also found only down in South Florida. So these are the cast of characters that make up the bat species that we have here in the state. So they roost in a variety of natural places, like I mentioned, like trees and cavities with peeling bark in royal palms, like the bonneted bat likes the royal palms down in South Florida, and then in caves that we have up here in North Florida. They're all insectivorous, so all the bats here are insectivorous. So they eat a variety of insects, including moths, mosquitoes, beetles, basically anything that they can. And so a lot of people love to talk about how many mosquitoes a bat can eat in an hour, and it's an impressive number. So they can eat up to 1,000 or more than 1,000 mosquitoes in an hour. And that's a small, like 14-gram bat. And then a nursing female who has babies to feed, or a baby to feed, can eat four times that. And they do have some natural predators, including raptors and owls and snakes. So if you ever have come to visit our bat houses here on campus, which are behind me on the Zoom screen here, my background, we have the world's largest bat houses. There's often a hawk that kind of hangs outside the bat house, and because he knows he's going to have an easy meal, because we have hundreds of thousands of Mexican free-tailed bats migrating out of that, but emerging out of the bat house every single night. So there's often a hawk hanging around waiting to scoop up one. So let's talk a little bit about bats as pollinators. So pollinating bats are found in a lot of places, primarily in the Africa, in the Pacific Islands, in Asia, and in some in South America, Central America, and a little bit into the United States. We'll talk about that as well. So bats pollinate over 300 different species of plants, including cocoa, banana, durian fruit, mangoes, agave, all kinds of plants depend or use bats as pollinators. And some plants are dependent only on bats as pollinators. They have developed a relationship where a bat is the only way that that plant gets pollinated. So what a bat pollinating bat does is, they go to the flowers to feed on the nectar and to also maybe eat some of the insects that might be hanging around in that flower. And then they get the pollen all over their fur, like we can see in this on this bat here. The greater long-nosed bat and that Cuban flower bat are both kind of covered in that yellow pollen. And then they fly to another plant, they transfer that pollen. And so that's how the plants get fertilized. That's how they increase their genetic diversity. And the bats get the nectar, and everybody benefits in this situation. So a lot of flowers have developed very unique ways to be pollinated by these bats, including these narrow flowers. Like you can see on the bottom here, this orange nectar bat, they have these long skinny tongues that get down to the bottom of that flower to drink up that nectar. And that way they can only be pollinated by that bat probably, and nothing else will be able to get to that nectar. So like I mentioned, a lot of these bats have developed these long tongues, and I like to this is an amazing example of specialization. So this is the tube-lipped bat, which is found in Ecuador. And this bat has the longest tongue of any mammal. So this bat is about 2 inches long, and that tongue is about 3 inches long. So it's 150% of its body length. And so it has developed this long tongue, and so it can feed off of these very special flowers that are only found in the cloud forests of Ecuador. So they have a very unique, close relationship with one another. So I'm gonna play this just really short clip. It's about 45-ish seconds long. Just kind of talks about bat pollination. So they can carry pollen farther than any other animal, and that's because they're flying, of course. So they can pollinate many essential night blooming plants. and plants like tequila, banana, and durian. Okay, so the types of flowers that bats like, that bats prefer, tend to be, of course, ones that open at night because bats are nocturnal and they're flying around at night. They're large in size, so the bats can easily find them when they're echolocating and looking for these fruit, for these flowers. And they tend to be pale or white in color. That only not only attracts the bats because they're easier to see at night because they're white, but the flowers themselves don't need to be flashy red, yellow, orange, like flowers that tend to be pollinated by birds and bees are, because they don't need to be. So that the plant doesn't waste its energy creating these vibrant colors because it's not necessary. And they also like flowers that tend to be strong smelling and have like a strong fruit-like odor, and that kind of helps the bats narrow down and find these flowers. And of course they want something with lots of nectar. So they can feed on those. So like I mentioned, we do have a couple of pollinator bats here in the United States. They are only found in Arizona, Texas, and New Mexico. And they are the Mexican long-tongued bat and the lesser long-tongued bat. And both of these species are endangered here in the United States. And they tend to specialize on the agave plants that we have here and also the saguaro cacti that are found in the American Southwest. And so they migrate between the South American Southwest down to Mexico. And so they come up here during the winter time because of the mild warm temperatures. So I also quickly want to talk a little bit about fruit eating bats, because they are kind of pollinators almost in their own little way. So fruit eating bats, like their name suggests, they eat fruit. And so they consume the seeds of the fruit and then they poop them out when they're flying around the forest. And so by pooping out these seeds all around the forest, they are spreading seeds, helping with forest regeneration, and helping increase the plant genetic diversity by spreading the genes all around. And so they get a meal, and the forest really benefits from the presence of the bats. And so bats are under a lot of threats. Over half of the bats in the United States today are either federally endangered, threatened, or of some kind of special concern. And they're under a lot of threat from a variety of places. So not only habitat destruction, so cutting down of trees that takes away the habitat that they need, entering like humans messing in caves and disturbing the bats and ruining caves where they're roosting is a problem. Bats, of course, are subject to the problems of climate change. So not only does that mess up their hibernation and the places where bats hibernate, but also just their ability to withstand certain temperatures, like the boxes or the roosting sites get too warm, or the caves are getting too warm for them. So climate change is actually a really strong factor in bats and affecting their survival. And also wind turbines, which not only affect bats, but can also affect bird populations. So there are a lot of studies going on in the tree to see how we can mitigate the effects of wind turbines, which are great for, you know, electricity and alternative energy, but not so great for flying animals. And then of course, bats are really affected by disease. And so I just wanna spend a second to talk a little bit about whiteness syndrome, which has really greatly negatively affected bat populations over the past 15 years or so, I think, since it first got discovered. So whiteness syndrome is actually caused by fungus that attaches itself to the fur and to the wings of hibernating bats. So it's only really found in caves, so cave roosting bats. And what happens is when the fungus grows on the bats, it wakes them up from hibernation. And so this disturbance causes them to use up energy stores that they need to use to survive a cold winter. So they're waking up in the middle of winter, there isn't much for them, if anything, for them to eat, and they're burning through all their energy and fat reserves because of this fungus. And so they essentially are starving to death. And it was first discovered in 2006, in that there's that red circle up there. And They think it was brought over from cavers in Europe, because it's a common fungus over in Europe in those caves, but the bats over there don't seem to be bothered by it. But over here, it was a novel fungus that got introduced. It quickly spread, as you can see through the map here, which shows the various time points showing it spreading down through the south into the southwest. And it has wiped out entire populations of bats and really caused severe damage to populations. And so now they are starting to rebound, it appears. A lot of that might be due to bats that were resistant to the fungus have now been able to, they survived it. They're passing on their genes to their offspring over the past, since 2006. And so those bats populations are slowly starting to come back. And there's also been a lot of management and a lot of research done on how to help bats that might currently have white nose to inoculate them with bacterium that helps fight the fungus and all kinds of methods to help prevent this from happening. So a lot of strict protocols now are in place for people who study bats to help prevent the transmission of the fungus. And it's unlikely that we will get any white nose syndrome here in Florida. We're just too warm. Our caves don't get the required temperature that would let it survive. But it's not out of the realm of possibility that a migrating bat like the tricolor bat that we do have in our caves could come down from, you know, Georgia or Alabama or Mississippi, where it has been detected and transmitted into our caves. And whether or not it would, you know, expand or even cause any effect, we don't know. But the bat biologists who work for the Florida Wildlife Commission, they actively monitor our bat caves and populations and test for white nose. So we'll be able to know if it does come down here and have a plan in place. But so it's not all doom and gloom. They are coming back, and there's a lot of things that we can do to help help with our bat populations. So I don't leave on such a down note. So one of the best things that we can do is provide bat habitat. And that includes not only natural habitat like forests and connected areas where the bats can go through, but also putting up things like bat houses if you're in an area that can benefit from a bat house. And there's some links here that you could go to check out how to get the best bat house for your area. Florida actually does have some very specific requirements that you can look up. Because we're such a hot, humid state, you want certain kinds of houses that would last a little bit better. And just learning about bats themselves and educating other people about bats and knowing that, you know, they're not scary animals. They aren't, you know, out to drink your blood or get in your hair. They're just out there living their lives, trying to eat insects and not really get in anybody's way. So knowing the best ways to handle them if you do come into contact with them, and then how to help, you know, help their populations around you are really the best ways to help protect our bats. And that's really all I had to say today. And I'm happy to take any questions you guys have.
Thank you so much for the really fascinating presentation. Just learning more about bats and their lifestyle and them in general. So we really, really appreciate you joining us today. We have quite a few questions already, so I'm going to relay those to you for our Q&A session. Our first one is from Miss Arana's class in Miami, and they want to know, how do they eat frogs?
So that is a good question. So they fly down and they are able to scoop up these frog species either from, you know, the water, like the areas that the frog is hanging out near like a lake or near a marshy area. They can echolocate, they can figure out where that frog is, and they scoop them up with their, it's hard to show because I'm not a bat, but they have like their tails, and they can scoop with their tails and then with their wings. And so they use their tails and their hind feet to kind of grab onto the bat, and then their front wings, and then they can just like shove them in their mouth, and they can fly away with the frog in their mouth. And they do the same thing with fish too. Like they can skim the top of water looking for small fish, and then they can just scoop up with their tails and get the fish that way.
It's really incredible. Miss Niebauer's group from Duval County asks, what characteristics differentiate the two families you spoke about earlier?
Oh, that's a good question. So there are some strong genetic differences between the two groups. So they're very genetically distinct. Some other characteristics are their dentition. So they have very different dentition. So the numbers of teeth that they have in their mouth vary. So I can look at a skull and tell you whether or not this is a Vespertilionidae skull versus a Molossidae skull based on its cranial characters. The Molossids, if we go back and we can, I think I stopped sharing, but their ears are very different from any other species of Vespertilionidae. Their ears are almost kind of connected in the middle, and they have these really low, tiny kind of like mouse-shaped ears, because I think that's what Molossidae kind of derives from, is like these little mouse shapes. And so a lot of external characters, like how they're, how furred their tails are. So like the Vespertilionids have really like furry tails, whereas like the free-tailed bats have very naked tails. So there's just like little characters between the two groups that kind of show them apart.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Next we have, how do their tongues fit in their mouth?
That is a good question. So for like the pollinator bats that have those really long tongues, I think they can kind of contract them down. They have the, you know, because the tongue's a muscle. So I think they just kind of like have them down in their throat area, and then they can just shoot them out of their mouths when they need to get down into the flowers. But that is a good question. I'm not 100% sure how they like keep their long tongues in their mouths, other than just kind of keeping them like maybe curled up or contracted a little bit.
Yeah, no problem. That sounds like something we'll all have to look into.
Yeah, right.
Our next question is from Natalie, who asks, when the bats' habitats are destroyed or changed, where do they go?
That is a great question. So they have to fly away and find a new habitat, right? Which might not always be easy, especially during the time when they might have pups. So that is something that I like to also bring up to people is, here in Florida, we're right now in the middle of, well, actually, we're getting ready to start maternity season. So bat maternity season is from April 15th, I believe, to August 15th. And so during this time period, you're not allowed to do any exclusions on bats because they're out there having pups. When their trees get cut down, they have to find a new home, which can be very stressful on the bat species. A lot of bats, they're capable of flying, of course, and flying some long distances. So, you know, hopefully they'll be able to find a new place to colonize rather quickly. But it just depends on the needs of the bat, right? And what they have to find. Like if they're a cave dwelling bat, they have to be able to find a new cave. That's why you want to be, if you have bats in your house, you know, you want to like make sure you're doing exclusions correctly and properly, and being aware, like if you have trees, like, you know, are there cavities in those trees? Could you investigate those cavities to see if there are bats, you know, in that cavity? It's always a problem when animals' habitats get destroyed. Like, you know, they just have to either die or they move on the best they can.
Sure. Our next question is there a cure for the fungus?
So there's not really a cure per se. They have been doing experiments to like, so there's a bacterium that I read about that they were able to like kind of inoculate the bats with, or like brush on their wings. And it seemed to slow down the spread of the fungus and maybe kill it a little bit. So it's not a pure cure. And I think there's been a lot of research on a few years. So there might have been something better now than what I'm not up on having read. But the best we can do is try to prevent it and slow it down when we do find it. But there isn't like a magic pill or spray that we can do to kill the fungus, unfortunately.
We have students and attendants who are wondering if bats only fly at night.
So the bats here that we have in North America are all nocturnal. So they're the bats that can be found in Africa and Asia, like those big flying foxes, you might see them a little bit more around in the daytime, at least like on their roosts, but bats primarily are nocturnal species. Yeah.
When scientists work with bats, how do they catch them?
So there's a lot of different ways. So what most people do is set up something called mist nets, which are these black fine mesh nets with poles on either end. And so what we like to do is if we're out netting for bats, a lot of times you want to find like an open area, like over a stream or a creek or something, because bats like to fly down these pathways. And because they're looking for insects over the water, they're looking for water to drink. So you find an open area wherever you're working, and you set up these mist nets, and they have different tiers. and little pockets kind of, so the bat gets caught in the mist net, might fall into the pocket or get kind of like tangled up a little bit into the net. And then you can go and untangle the bat very carefully and put them in a bag and then handle them that way. Another way that we catch bats, and this is what we do in the Bahamas when we've gone down there for field work, is we use basically hand nets, like almost like butterfly nets. And because these bats are roosting up in the tops of caves and in little bell holes in the cave. So we kind of like get the hand net up into the bell hole, like to cover it up. And then the bats fly into the net and we kind of twist the net around really fast and get the bat and then pull them out of the net that way. So those are the two most common ways to get bats. And also mentioned, if you're netting in a cave, a lot of times we'll put the nets in front of the cave entrance. So when they're emerging at night, they'll fly into that net when they're emerging out of the cave.
I wish I could spend all day asking you questions because I'm learning so much, but we'll just do maybe one or two more.
Okay. I'm happy to go as long as you need or as you want.
Can bats sneeze? For example, when they are covered with pollen, can they sneeze?
You know, I don't know the answer to that. That seems like something that you would want to do naturally. I mean, I know I do this time of year. I'm sneezing all the time. I'm surprised I haven't sneezed yet today. I really don't know the answer to that. That is something I'm going to have to look up. I'm gonna write that down right the second I remember to see if that sneeze. I love this.
Learning opportunity for all of us.
Yeah.
Can bats create new species of flowers when they're carrying around the pollen?
Oh, that is an interesting question. You know, I don't know that anybody has discovered that, because they are helping with the genetic diversity of bats as they are moving pollen from one flower to another, but it's usually within the same species. So I think it's unlikely that they would create a new species of flower, but you never know if they cross-pollinate a closely related species to another species and make a new variety. I mean, it's totally within the realm of possibility, I would think, but I'm not 100% sure.
All right, and let's actually just wrap up with one more. Yeah. Can the white nose sickness go to humans?
No, it cannot. So it's only found on bats and has not been transferable to any other species. That's a good question, yeah.
All right. Well, I can't thank you enough. I really enjoyed chatting with you and I really enjoyed your presentation. So thank you so much.
I enjoyed this so much. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah, I'm going to turn things over to Stephanie.
Thanks, Brian. And thanks, Verity, so much. That was a fascinating presentation. And we're so happy to have you on the call with us today. So that wraps up things for today. You can visit us next time on May 17th at 10 a.m. to listen to If You Build It, They Will Come. It's going to be all about butterfly gardens. And we ask if you'll take a moment to complete the survey that's been put in the chat box. It's also on your screen here. That would be very informative for us as a team. And finally, you can learn more about Mount's Botanical Garden and Scientists in Every Florida School by visiting the websites you see here on your screen. You can follow us on social media, and you can also hop over to our YouTube channel where there will be a recording of today's event along with the curated K-12 extension activities and resources. Thank you again, everyone. We hope to see you next time. Have a great day. Bye-bye.